Hey folks, Kilt-Man here. Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? I hope you're all doing very, very well. Now, before we begin, I've got to say, I've been asked about my little intro. That whole thing you just heard there. Hey folks, Kilt-Man here. Kilt-Man at your services. How are you all? Blah, 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 blah. Do you mean what you say? Yeah, I do. It's been a mantra for many, many years now, and I won't lie to you, I've thought a few times, like, oh, can I change that? Can I, you know, shift it up a gear or do something different? But the very thing is, look, I'm saying, it's Kilt-Man here, Kilt-Man, me, at your services. How are you all? I'm genuinely asking how you are, and the thing is, a lot of you do get back to me, whether it's comments down below, not Rudy down below, but comments on the channel, or people who message me privately, and there's so many of you guys that do that, which is wonderful. Yeah, I do mean it. It's genuinely, it's sincere. I know you can't answer back, yes, we're doing fine, or no, sorry, I've got a bad leg, or this has happened, and I can't afford the mortgage repayments, and Kilt-Man, can you help me out? No, Kilt-Man can't help me out. I wish I could, but I can't. But I always genuinely wish that you're all happy and well. And I do mean that sincerely. We're a clan. That's the way I view it. Anyone who joins this channel and becomes a friend, of which so many of us are now, and look, the fact that a lot of you guys have got to meet each other via the comments down below and found each other on social media and become friends and have had loads of banter and repartee and made great friendships, that's great. That's all I can ask for. It's all I want is to bring us all together and to talk about movies and stuff and things happening. And what's happening now? Well, okay. A little aside right now. Furiosa, me and my son are watching it. 10:30, Friday morning, UK time, that is. The first showing in the UK officially. Didn't get invited to any premieres, did I? Even though I'm the biggest, extoller and the Ayatollah of the wasteland of rock and roller. Yeah, I got that wrong, I know, but who cares? The biggest Mad Max magnum opus fan you could ever hope to meet. But did anyone invite me to Cannes to watch it? No. Any premieres? No. For Fury Road, I got invited to premieres and reviewed them. Funny how I've been bigging Furiosa up so much that no one has actually bothered to ask me this time around. But hey ho, it's the way the world turns. Who cares? I will give it loads. You guys know that. Anyway, so that's coming up. So Furiosa is a big thing. But something else is up and coming. Another fantastical, far-fetched, highly imaginative telling of a story that a lot of us know and love. It's Time Bandits. Terry Gilliam's Monty Python-esque, imaginative, highly inventive, hugely inspirational and highly, influential 1981 fantasy, Time Bandits. I've covered it before. I know it. You all know it. We love it. A team of dwarfs who are in charge of trees and shrubbery in the creation of the world from the supreme being got kind of bored and stole a map. The map of all the time holes and time warps and black holes in the whole time-space continuum. And then go through all of history and creation. Stealing things, nicking that, and doing this, and changing the course of history. And they go and meet a little kid, Kevin. Little Kevin. Kevin from possibly a very borderline abusive family background. This is Gilliam, you know. Gilliam had dark satire. It was a kid's fantasy, and yet it so wasn't. It was dark, it was sinister, it was scary, but it was hysterically funny, and it was alarmingly anarchic, which is brilliant. And as a kid, you love that. And as an older kid, you still love it. You love it even more now. You understand its value even more when you're older than when you were as a kid. When you're a kid, it's opening doors to imagination. But when you're older, it's like, it's a doorway back to a halcyon time where anything could happen. And Gilliam knew this. It's almost like Gilliam knew that, like, look, this will be looked on for forevermore and will be revered for being, you know, just avant-garde. And, like, it's adventure. It's what kids' imaginations truly, really are. All your best dreams and a lot of the worst ones as well. I know, I buggered up the tagline from it. But your best dreams and your worst nightmares. But that's what Time Bandits genuinely is. And of course, it's a cult classic. What happens to cult classics? They get rebooted, do they not? By all and sundry. So we're getting Time Bandits rebooted. Yeah, okay. A bunch of dwarves who steal a map with all the time holes from the Supreme Being and then have to fight evil, played by David Warner, who's a technocrat, which is microwaves and video cassette recorders, and he loves just technology. It was 1981, or film 1980, but it was about the cusp of CDs and technology, microwaves and all this sort of stuff. And Ralph Richardson plays the Supreme Being, aka God, who's an authoritarian bureaucrat. That's all he is. Times and targets and, you know, this, that and the other. You know, it's brilliant. It takes an American, Terry Gilliam, to realise the American the British ridiculousness of life. Which, of course, the irony being that British society and British sort of technology and British forthright business acumen, all it did was nick the American business model and copy it and do it for its own, for queen and glory. Back in 1980-81. But the film is genius. It's funny. David Rappaport, that's Randall, the leader of this little diminutive band of time bandits. What a great title as well. And like they're plundering left, right and centre. They got pissed off with doing trees and shrubbery at the creation of the earth and mankind. Oh, we want more than that. So they do. And the reason why they're dwarves is, well, Kevin, the kid, the little kid, who inadvertently falls into their grasp and becomes a hostage, but then one of their loyal confidants and a saviour for them as well, goes on this big odyssey throughout time and space and different dimensions, meeting the Titanic, Robin Hood, Napoleon Bonaparte, Agamemnon, played by Sean Connery, and then the ogres and displaced evils, you know, dungeons and temple. He's one of them because that's why he wants adventure. So little people and a kid, little people, it worked. Why am I labouring this? Well, the point is this. The entire Time Bandits movie from Terry Gilliam, it doesn't make an issue of the fact that why did they have to be dwarves? These guys in charge of shrubberies and trees and blah, 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 didn't have to be dwarves. But Gilliam did it because, well, my central character, well, your audience conduit into this adventure is a small kid, well, a 12-year-old lad, Kevin. And so we're going to have him fall into, you know, the gang of people his own size. And they're all idiots. They're all crazy, chaotic, bizarre dudes with all their own bizarre traits and all that. Like, so, but he loves them. And he becomes part of their little tribe, their little clan, their gang. And the entire movie is built out of jokes and references to their lack of stature. It's not made a you're not told why they had to be dwarves. That's not the issue. But the fact that they are, and all played by real life dwarves, is the major thing. That's the point. And we love it and revere it for that. A lot of these guys were very famous, you know, diminutive actors, who were in many other movies as well. And so you remake it, you reboot it, and what do? Well, what's the age we live in right now? Oh yeah, yeah, woke. And a guy called, what's his fucking name? I forgot his name now. Taika Waititi. Taika Waititi. New Zealander. Taika Waititi. Now remakes it, reboots it for a TV show for Apple Plus TV. Apple TV. And it's a TV show. And he was initially meant to be doing writing and directing the first episode. But apparently he's doing all the episodes, so far as I know, and they filmed it. But has he got dwarves in there? The Time Bandits are all full size, and they're multi-ethnic, multicultural, multicolour. Haven't you seen this before? What did Disney do with, is it cancelled? I hope it is. Their Snow White live action version, where Snow White is black, and all the look. I don't care what you think. Don't think that I'm being uber nasty. I'm not. It's just this is the woke culture destroying things. Disney destroying things. Disney's not got a part in this, but it's still the same ethos behind it, the same modus operandi. But Snow White, they weren't dwarfs. They were all multi-ethnic, human-sized, normal people. The whole point of Snow White is that she's Snow White. It's written. The Brothers Grimm, she's written. She's Snow White. She's not black. And the dwarfs are dwarfs. It's as simple as that. So why have you got to make it all and everything, but no dwarfs in there? And of course, this has been pretty much cancelled. Has that film come out? No, it hasn't. Has it even been finished being made? I'm not even sure it has. Has it been completely kiboshed? Hopefully so. Looks like shite. And now we get this. Now, Taika Waititi, Flight of the Conchords, What We Do in the Shadows, absolutely awesome. With his regular, I forgot his name now, but I'll find it here right now. His regular writing partner, Jermaine Clement. These two have worked together throughout TV shows and movies. Taika Waititi is a writer, director, producer, actor. He's done everything. Jojo Rabbit was a very difficultly clever satire. Absolutely bizarre when you think about it, what the concept was, but brilliant. What we did in the shadows, vampires, werewolves, and all that, in a sort of realistic context, is genius. Thor Ragnarok. Yes, he got his big break into big movies with Thor for Marvel. Thor Ragnarok. I absolutely adored Thor Ragnarok. I've talked about it a lot. Chris Hemsworth was given his comedic bent, and he's great at doing it. And I thought the film was great. It got the balance was right. The mix of high drama, action, Marvel, super shenanigans, and genuine pathos was in there. It was genius. And then he did Thor, Love and Thunder. And obviously all the accolades given to him by the Marvelites for Ragnarok, for making it just a bit more fun, not po-faced, he took it too far. Way too far. Christian Bale is a god killer. And sweet Jesus, I loved and adore and still do Thor Ragnarok. I hate and despise Thor Love and Thunder. It's great as a TV trailer. It's great. You know, give it 90 seconds or even a minute and a half. Hang on, 90 seconds is a minute and a half. But it's great. It's funny. All the best bits of Love and Thunder are in there. And you get the sense of humour. You get the chaotic sense of anarchic satire and just devil-may-care bullshit. It works. Hemsworth can do that. And Taika Waititi can do it. But my God, watching a full-length two-hour-plus movie, it was an absolute... It was having like... spikes into your bollocks. It was slow and dreary and so bizarrely ridiculous. Oh, we're trying to make you laugh. We're doing this, we're doing that, I hated it. It was the biggest, like, I can't wait for this. I did videos building it up and then I sat and watched it and I was like, hey, and that smile just drooped down to my ankles. And in the end, I just make it stop. I couldn't believe how bad it was. And the thing is, the backlash was immense against Love and Thunder. But Taika Waititi didn't give two shits about it. He didn't care. This is a guy who's shagging Rita Ora, for Christ's sake. You know, he didn't give a toss. He was like, all his accolades for Jojo Rabbit and for Ragnarok and... We're doing the shadows, went right up his ass and blew smoke out of his ears. And now he directed and wrote one of The Mandalorian, and he's done something else. And of course, Disney won him for Star Wars. Fuck off. This guy had a massive climb to a great, bizarre, off the kilter, avant-garde stuff. But now he's going for mainstream. And he's destroying everything. He ruined Thor. Ruined it. And then, of course, now he gets Time Bandits for a TV show. Now, TV shows of big, massively loved fantasy franchises. Well, Rings of Power. Enough said. Willow. Little people again, but massively enough said. Wokey-eyes beyond belief. Possibly one of the worst things I've ever seen, ever. And I've watched films from Uwe Boll. But what garbage was that? What utter garbage. And now you bring Taika Waititi in to do a TV reboot, retweak of Time Bandits. Only they're not dwarves, they're full-sized people. Or are they? We've got the image is on the thumbnail. You've seen the thumbnail. You go online, you'll see the first production image from the TV show. And they all appear to be, you know, full-sized human beings with a little kid whose name is, his name's Kal-El. He's a British-born lad. His fucking name's Kal-El. Kal-El? You kidding me? Fucking kryptonite. Let's just see. What's his name? Oh, God. No, it's not. Oh, God. Oh, it's here somewhere. Right. It is. Fucking hell. British actor. Oh. Tuck. 11-year-old Kevin. What's his fucking name? It just says Tuck. His name's... It's Kal-El Tuck. Kal-El Tuck. Sorry about the pontificating there. And the slow boating. But it's true. Kal-El Tuck plays Kevin. So you've still got Kevin, the young kid, who will obviously be caught up and embroiled in the Time Bandits saga of crossing time zones and dimensions and history, rewriting things, helping things happen to be history, and nicking things and being traced. Well, we presume chased by the Supreme Being, who wants his map back and to put them back in their place. But also, you must have evil must be there. The David Warner character, evil must be there. With his acolytes who are doing machinations and trapping them and luring them in and capturing them and doing things. That's got to be there too. I'll read out the names. The cast also includes Tag Murphy, Roger Jean, Nzgugimiami Vamba, Rune Tamte, Kiri Thompson, Rachel House, Matt King, George Hevudas, Zoe Ventura, and Charlene Yee. Right, remember that name, Charlene Yee. A lot of these will be native New Zealanders. But they're not small people, they're normal tall people, and they are differently coloured, so you've got that. So they're definitely doing, every ethnic minority is going to be in here, but no dwarves. Or are they going to do the thing, because I don't know this for a fact, I mean, I'm willing to believe maybe they're going to do their Peter Jackson Lord of the Rings thing where, you know, they're going to shrink down, you know, like the hobbits, shrink them down, do visuals, and, like, you know, use little smaller people to run alongside for, you know, rear shots or long shots. Are they going to do that? Bollocks, it's a TV show, they're not going to do that at all. They're not arsed, these aren't going to be dwarves at all. They're going to be taller people, and they are what's classed as the idiots. Not so much time bandits, it's a gang. A band of these, well, you know, time wandering thieves, but they're the idiots. Now, in Gilliam's hands, all of them, you know, Randall, Strutter, Og, the whole bunch of them, some of them are here, the figures are here, they were buffoons. They could traverse time and space, but they couldn't tie their own shoelaces, you know. They were complete and utter doofuses, dickheads, and they fought amongst themselves. But they had a bunch of, you know, great, genuine, almost British squaddy camaraderie amongst themselves, honour amongst thieves and all that. But no, this mob, who the hell knows? Because who's their leader? David Rappaport played Randall, who was the leader of the original Time Bandits. David Rappaport, sad story with him. Went to America after Time Bandits, did a lot of TV shows, went out into the desert and shot himself. And that was not... I don't know the full story behind that. I don't think anyone will ever know that full story. But horribly tragic. But replacing him as a character is... who? Lisa Kudrow. Yeah, Lisa Kudrow from Friends. Smelly cat. Yeah, that's her. Apparently, Taika Waititi and the other guy from, the Concords, and his long-standing writing collaborator. They were both massive fans of Lisa Kudrow, but especially Taika Waititi, who claims to be a huge fan of Terry Gilliam's original Time Bandits. But no, I love Friends, and Lisa Kudrow, oh, I want to work with her. So when they actually brought her in for an interview, well, not so much a casting interview, just to say, like, I want to play this part. I've kind of written it for you. He was wearing a smelly cat T-shirt. He claims, I just wear it all the time. I didn't do it on purpose, but I always wear it. I even forgot I was wearing it. And oh, what a coincidence. Okay. Lisa Kudrow, I do think one of the characters in Friends which I actually genuinely love most than anybody else. You know, all the other characters were great, and the ensemble were terrific together. But she was the one that kind of stood out from everybody else because she was so just out there. And in a way, I can kind of get that. She's the most Gilliam-esque of characters from Friends, if you could turn any of them as Gilliam-esque. And this is what I'm coming to. I cannot stand I don't use the term woke, but you're not using dwarfs. Whether you like it or not, Terry Gilliam with Time Bandits didn't specify why they had to be dwarfs, but the entire film made a huge thing out of their size. That was massive, and size was massive. Their diminutive size was massive, but you know what I mean? It was important, but it's because Kevin is a kid and he sees these are like other kids to help him escape from an adult-dominated world who doesn't care about him. His mum and dad don't give two shits about him. He finds kindred spirits with these small guys and goes off with them on adventures, and they form a huge bond. So you can see why that happens. How the hell is that going to transpire with like a small kid with a bunch of like adult-sized, multi-ethnic bizarrities known as the idiots? Really? I find that quite a lot more disturbing, to be honest. To go with a bunch of like adults. Really? No, I'm throwing stuff which has no bearing, but I just don't see why they've changed these things. But on the flip side of that, because you know what I'm like, I'm Gemini, so I see both sides and I've got multiple points of view and I'm very two-faced about things. I can almost see what could be taking place here. Taika Waititi, I said before, is a master of anarchic slapstick, great dialogue, really bizarre visual antics, and a really sort of, you know, avant-garde and sort of askew sense of humour, which you saw in Thor Ragnarok. You saw in there, he took the staple of, you know, vampires and werewolves and ghosts with what we see in the shadows, what we do in the shadows, and how he manipulated that and made it really great fun as well, but still kept what the ethos of all these creatures really is and made it like everyday sort of drama comedy. Brilliant. So we can do all that. So if you can hear, there's a huge monsoon taking place here. You know, it really is coming down like a bastard right now. But so with that comedic slant, all those different avenues of comedy that he can explore, that's actually very Monty Python and Terry Gilliam. That's what they did. There was slapstick, there was bizarre wordplay, there was crazy characters, there was just a lot of strange stuff taking place, completely, you know, outside of normal conventional comedy shows. It would poke fun at society, morals, and politics. And that's what he does. So that works. Taika Waititi on paper actually is, you know, now he can make this work. But it's already changed things too much. And this is a guy that breathed fresh air into Marvel with Thor Ragnarok and gave Chris Hemsworth the chance to really poke fun at a po-faced character and have fun doing it. Sorry, I've been yakking way too long with no lubrication. There's nothing. I have nothing. There's no whiskey here to drink. Nothing. I'm bereft of whiskey, sadly. Don't worry. I was out before, and I'm sure you could probably tell. But so he gave him such an avenue to explore for, you know, Chris Hemsworth to be comedic, and it was great. It subverted the Marvel stuff. Sorry again. And then he did Love and Thunder, which was ridiculous. Christian Bale had so much stuff to do as the God Killer and was genius. If you watch the outtake scenes, there's loads more of Christian Bale. The tragedy of what he was doing, the reasons why he was doing what he did. Sorry, but all they did was focus on, no, we cut out all that. They filmed it, but cut all the emotional stuff out. It's made a complete buffoonery, a lampoon show. It was Caddyshack with the, you know, the gods of Nordic lore. It was ruined, but Taika Waititi got it up his arse that I'm a genius at this. Only you're not. So my problem with this is not so much that they're not dwarves. That is a problem. But my real problem is that it's him behind it, writing it, directing it. It's going to be shite. It's going to be shite. Because I think he no longer knows the parameters. He'll just go way beyond and destroy all the fun setup, maybe, and then just be ridiculously anarchic. And you'll lose the thread of the actual story. Now, it's a series, of course. I'm not sure how many episodes it is. It might say in this stuff here. I don't know. But who cares? Oh, yeah. When Lisa turned up, Taika was wearing a smelly cat T-shirt, his mate says. That wasn't on purpose, Waititi insists with a laugh. I forgot I was wearing it. My ass. Now, there's also been complaints about this. Recently. I think the person I named before, who was it now? Charlene or Charline Yee has complained, as someone else has as well, unnamed as far as I know, about physical abuse on set from another actor. They haven't said who the actor is, but Apple and all the producers are looking into it with a big investigation. And, well, I don't know the story. I don't know. They've said they were abused physically and psychologically, and we're in a good time. So, oops-a-daisy, this ain't working out, is it? Now, I don't want to be a doom-monger about these things. I love everything. I want things to succeed. I want to be reported. Oh, this is great. There's nothing better than saying, wow, have you seen this? Well, this happens and this happens. It's bloody great. You'll love this. Let's watch it. Oh, God, you'll have a ball. I love that more than anything else. I know so many other people on YouTube just love to denounce everything under the sun. And I've done a fair bit of that myself. But I've done it with my reasons, and I've always validated my reasons. I've always backed it up with huge evidence and opinion. This, well, it ain't boding too well, is it? Fact, they're not dwarves anymore. Unless they're going to do what Peter Jackson did. So all the hobbits were sort of like, they were shrunk down visually. Also, all they were walking in little troughs while the big people, normal sized people, were walking alongside them. There is a film with Alan Ladd and, what is her name? The most sultry goddess of cinema. Oh, black haired, gorgeous eyed, voluptuous. What the hell's her name now? Sophie Loren. They did a film in the, was it early 60s, called Boiling a Dolphin, right? Boiling a Dolphin refers to a piece of treasure down in the Aegean Sea, which they're trying to find this. They're diving down trying to find it. 5 minute a score by Hugo Friedhofer. In fact, I'm going to play it now. I've been playing Time Bandits, the Time Bandits score, but screw that right now. Let's go and find Boiling a Dolphin. Because I must have it. If I do not have it, I will be really, really annoyed. We have it. And I'm going to play Nocturnal at Sea. This is by Hugo Friedhofer. And it's one of those underwater classics, but it's about skullduggery and treasure hunting. But Alan Ladd, Shane, plays, he's the treasure hunter. But he's a small guy. He's a little fella. He's not a dwarf, but he could well be. Small guy. Sophia Loren is statuesque, and the word goddess totally applies. I never use the word beautiful with women. I very rarely ever do. Women are, their heart, they're fit, they're gorgeous. Gorgeous is the one that really, but beautiful is a term which two or three women in the world, in existence, will ever earn that title. Mrs. Kilt-Man's one of them. But Sophia Loren, she's in this, and listen to this music, and she's swimming as well, like in little skimpy 50s, 60s swimsuits. My word. But Alan Ladd is tiny man. The two of them walking together. What they did, they built a trench for her to walk alongside him, and they also put blocks for him to walk. So they were sort of standing because they have a romance together. Fucking as if. And they're walking the sort of like, you know, together, the same sort of height. It's complete bullshit. So what I'm saying is, like, are they gonna do that with Taika Waititi's Time Bandits? Because we don't yet know. We've got the cast photo, they're all stood there. It could be a piss take, it could be like, look, yeah, you're all gonna go mad about this. They're not dwarves. Ah, but we're gonna shrink them digitally, or we're gonna do it with like trickery. Nah, I don't believe that. I don't think he cares about that. He's called his bunch of Time Bandits the Idiots, led by Lisa Kudrow. I do like her. I'll be honest, I do like her. I think she's actually quite a comedic genius. Her timing and her stylings are great. But does that mean she can play a David Rappaport Randall character? They're clearly going to reinvent the whole thing. So is each episode going to be a different time period? Or are they going to combine loads and jump about a lot? Like, I mean, Quantum Leap did this sort of thing way back in the day. I don't know. I'm not wholly against this. I mean, you may think that what I've been saying that I am. I'm not. I do think that Taika Waititi, it has got the sort of the Monty Python, Terry Gilliam style. in his DNA. I think he's got that bizarrety, that poking fun, the set piece anarchy, the verbal bullshittery. He can do all of that really well, and that could really work. It's just, why have you not embraced what Time Bandits was all about? It's about little people doing big things. That's what it's about. That was the huge metaphor, I think. And you're not doing that. But the concept, I suppose, is more open to any interpretation. So I'm not massively going to denounce this. I've got reasons to, like, you know, go, argh. But until we see it, you don't know. But the track record of these things being reinvented, Rings of Power, Willow, sweet Jesus, it does not bode too spectacularly well. And I love Time Bandits. It's one of the greatest fantasies that Britain's ever produced, and it took an American to do it as well. Like, but like American Werewolf was one of the greatest horror movies ever made, and it took an American to do it, but set it in Britain, you know, with an entirely British cast, mostly British cast, you know. This is this. Sophie Loren. She's took over this video now. You try and find this movie, Bugging the Dolphin. It's not a great film. It isn't. But it's great to watch Sophie Loren. My God. A goddess. And again, the word beautiful. Beautiful is setting. Look. The eyes, the face, the hair, everything. The sensuality. Where am I going with this? And why am I doing this? But who cares? You're all loving it. You're all Googling Sophia Loren right now. Yeah, I know you are. She's possibly one of the most beautiful women the world has ever known. Forget Helen of Troy. Forget that. Fucking Sophia Loren would be there, like. It'd be Armageddon, literally. Nah, she's the real deal. Amazingly beautiful. So anyway, Time Bandits via Taika Waititi could be interesting, could be a calamity. Let's see what else. I say there's controversy over it now behind the scenes. You know, people have made complaints about physical abuse, physical and psychological abuse by another actor. Taika Waititi tends to act in a lot of movies as well, whether it's behind a CG veneer. Look at Korg in the Thor movies. So, I don't know what's happening. Maybe Rita Ora could give us some behind the scenes little anecdotes. I don't know. Let's see what happens. I don't know what to think of it. I genuinely don't. But I'm looking at the image right now, which you're seeing on the thumbnail. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 Time Bandits. There's more Time Bandits than that. So I'm presuming there might be more. Or if that's the major crew, I don't know. I really don't know. Lisa Kudrow. You've got, like, there's a genuine Chris Hemsworth looking character on the far right as you look at it. And you've got, like, a guy that looks Scottish. He's got long red hair. You've got, like, a bit of a sort of Tam O'Shanter taking place, if I can tell rightly. He's not wearing a kilt, though, I'll be honest. He's not wearing a kilt. But a lot of his clothing does look very, very Scottish. Very Highlander, but we'll see. I'm looking at the landscape. Well, it's New Zealand, isn't it? Which has a landscape to match anywhere in the world. You've got glaciers there. You've got jungle. You've got rainforest. You've got mountains. You've got also, you've got grasslands. You've got everything is in New Zealand, which is why Peter Jackson did Middle Earth there. So they're filming it there. I will be interested to see how this turns out. So let me know below what you think. I know I've been quite rambling with this, but I've had a load of whiskies, and I got told that we could be on the brink of World War III. Oh, what? Really? Really? Again? How many times have I heard this? Loads. What it is, folks, is what it is. Please be yourselves. Don't worry about a damn thing. Whatever Taika Waititi does, it'll probably be the worst thing that's going to come along in the next couple of years. Let's hope so. But anyway, in the meantime, and it's ever like, are we dwarves? Are we shrunken? Are we visual effects? But who cares? We're multi-ethnic and we're going to appeal to every, you know, demographic known to man and woman and non-binary personage. Because we're a TV show that wants to, like, we're inclusive. And clearly this is doing that. But it could still work, says the guy in a Big Trouble Little China vest. And the Mackenzie, ancient Mackenzie kilt, and the US cavalry belt. How about that for fucking inclusive and diversifying? I've covered multiculturals right there and then. There you go, in one body. Folks, I have been watching Abbey Kilt-Man. Please, in the meantime, and it's ever, oh fucking who cares in between time, please keep it Kilt-Man, keep it Kilt-Man. And I'm gonna see you all. Leaders. And although almost everybody in the world seems to have seen Furiosa, and I haven't yet, I will be within the next 48 hours. And I will be covering it extensively. I'll be covering it more than anybody else on the fucking planet will cover it. You know it. And hopefully you can't wait for it. But it will be. Furiosa rules. But Mad Max is actually rules even more. I can't wait. Folks, gonna see it all later. Blah de blah and blah blah blah. Little people will take over the world. They should. It's their right.